Ukrainian concert pianist Valentina Lisitsa is the most popular classical pianist on YouTube. Her channel has received almost 50 million hits, and she's in demand as a pianist all over the world. So I'm delighted that she's taken some time out of her very, very busy schedule to join me here today for a classical conversation in Cardiff. Welcome, Valentina. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Melanie. I'm so delighted to talk with you.
Oh, it's wonderful.
On camera.
Well, I want to start by asking you a little bit about your musical education, because you started at three.
Three and 8 months, which is a huge difference. It's a huge difference. It's a quarter of life.
But you come from a non-musical family, mm-hmm. so what attracted you to the piano? How did you start?
But you know, in many countries, for example, now that China is experiencing the same, you know, millions of parents have dreams for their children, you know, that they will go and become pianists. So there are thousands, you know, hundreds of thousands of pianos being built, purchased, kids studying it. And the same phenomenon was at that time in Soviet Union. You know, my parents, you know, they, like every set of parents, they were dreaming about better future for their children. So by 3 years old, they tried me in just about anything, you know, that usually comes in mind to push a parent, except tennis, which is strange, because probably that would be good. But they tried me in figure skating, in ballet, in swimming, and I was such a miserable failure in all of those, you know, I was discarded. Those were very tough, you know, teachers, coaches, because everything was so professional, so competitive, so competition-oriented, everything, including music. So, you know, I would come in front of teacher of ballet, you know, very famous teacher, and she would, you know, look, just give one look to 3 year old and discard you, just talking in your face, saying, well, she's no good, and so on. So that's the end of. But music somehow, you know, it was non-offensive, non-denominational, and safe.
And you were very, very good at it. So
yes,
obviously.
And besides, I had my older brother to compete against, because he was quite an accomplished pianist, but so basically, you know, I started piano to prove to him that I can do it too, because, you know, having 10 years difference, I was constant, you know, subject of abuse of all kinds.
So did you go straight away to a conservatoire as a young girl, or did you start with private lessons? How does it work in
Kiev? I went, the system of education was such, because most of course, you know, when you go to music education, most of people, they cannot possibly count on becoming, you know, concert pianists. So yes, that's the idea. But to be realistic, most of those, you know, kids, college kids who went to music, they wanted to become music teachers. And because music was taught in schools, in just regular schools, so that was quite a nice way to do it. That was actually a dream of my mom, you know, to of getting, you know, at least, you know, if I'm total failure, I will get to be teacher, music teacher in just regular, you know, primary school, and I will have 3 months vacation, and, you know, September 1st, all teachers, all parents bring you flowers and chocolate, so it's nice, you know,
nice
that was a good idea, because she was on giving end, you know, as a parent, you know, bringing chocolates and flowers to teachers. But most of kids were actually going into teaching career, and to better educate them to do it, there were lots of young kids who were given to those beginner students to be taught immediately, like guinea pigs. So my first lessons were with a very young girl. Of course, she seemed, you know, like grown-up lady for me, but I think she probably was like 16 or 17. But that was my first musical experience being taught by a piano student.
Right, right. So I want to talk about your technique. Now, I hope you don't mind me saying, but it's not traditional Russian school, is it?
No.
It's quite different, and you appear to stroke the notes rather than you, they use their body in quite a different way.
Yes, body, actually, lower body. You know, I always joke so badly about so-called Russian music school, piano school, because, you know, people try to put you in those boxes and pigeonholes and
they
say
do.
You belong to, of course, you know, if you come from Russia, you must belong to the school. And then I joke, what is Russian school? You know, you usually imagine, you know, those muscular
men
pounding on the piano, you know, breaking strings and everything. So, and I was joking that you have to play with your, you know, lower body parts, you know, put weight from your behind on the keys, and I'm totally opposite of it. And
yes.
I don't actually know how my technique came along. I guess it was a sense of huge protest, because I was not only contrarian, even 3 years old. And you know, after I studied a little bit with this young girl, because I was such a promising student, I was given to a teacher who actually taught in conservatory, who was quite famous. And there were struggles began. Because, of course, I was exemplary student, so I was taken to all lectures that he was given, you know, around Ukraine and showing, you know, it was exhibition lessons that he was given. And of course, I would always spoil the fun because I would do everything opposite, or I would do something that my teacher would ask in such a way, you know, to make a caricature of it. You know, I remember clearly, you know, when one of those occasions, and Russian teachers, you know, they're not about, oh yes, you're doing such a great job, you know, all this encouraging stuff, you know, you fly out of the room and music flies after you. But I remember clearly one occasion, you know, when he complained that I'm playing, you know, with my hands hanging down, as I do, and my elbows are down. And he said, my elbows have to be in position. So next time I come and my elbows are like that, and I'm playing with a grin on my face. And of course, it made him terribly mad. But I think I was finding, you know, constantly comfortable way to do it. Whatever it takes, even if it looks strange or, you know, non-typical. If it was comfortable, there is no effort just in technique, because there is such a huge effort that goes into, you know, mental and emotional thinking music. But technique, if you don't think of technique as the beginning and the end, it's just, you know, it's physiological thing. We breathe in and out when we talk, you know, we walk. Yes, you know, some people walk faster than others, so some people are having trouble, but still, you know, we function.
Yes, I can understand. So, did you do a lot of competitions as a young girl? How did you get your performance practice?
Yes, I played a lot on stations. That was my favorite part. But with playing on stage just from people, of course, came competition part, which was not such a favorite thing. I loved competitions, you know. I was very competitive, but yet it was not about music at all. And for young child, it's very difficult to understand, you know, there are kinds of sports where everything is very clear, you know, you have, you know, basically stopwatch, you have, you know, height, you know, how high people jump.
Yeah.
If you have soccer, you know, you have goals, you can measure it. In music, you cannot measure it.
No.
In anything. Look, even in figure skating or, you know, in gymnastics, there are so much controversial decisions.
Yes.
You know, once you talk about art part, you know, expressive part, it's impossible to measure. But in music, it's thousands times as much. And also, you know, the things with judges, you know, with basically teachers who know each other, who do favors to each other, you know, there is certain pecking order, who wins next time, who never wins, which is impossible to comprehend for a child. That was a very frustrating part.
Yeah, I can imagine. So when did you decide, when was the light bulb moment and you thought, I've got to be a pianist?
Look, I always loved, you know, playing for people, you know, sharing my joy, you know, when I would discover new pieces, when I learned something, share it with someone.
Yes.
It was absolutely separate from competition. Actually, music was divided into competition part, but also just share pleasure of music making, which was taking place not in this, you know, piano class, but, you know, in accompaniment class and chamber music class, where you just side read something. You know, we went with my accompaniment teacher and with singer, we went through all Schubert songs, all Rachmaninov songs, all Tchaikovsky. So I loved that Rachmaninov. You know, Rachmaninov of songs, and I absolutely despise it, Rachmaninov of concerto, where you have to compete and you have to play a certain way. Yes. So it was like absolute split personality. But eventually, you know, my artistic personality would take over, you know, and I became less and less successful in competitions because I did not comply, I did not do what I was supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I was happy in a way because I was disturbing people.
I can imagine, yes. Well, next thing I want to ask you is about your composers. Which one do you really love to play, or which ones do you feel kind of more at home with than others, would you say?
There are so many composers.
Yeah, I know.
It's so difficult to choose. And but I don't look for particular composers, or, you know, I'm not specializing in particular repertory or epoch or style. But actually, every time when there is a lot of more emotional charge, it's not about purely relaxing music, and I abhor music which is just for, you know, for surfacey, for this brilliant virtuoso effect. You know, when there is nothing behind that effect, I lose interest very quickly. You know, I played my fair share of those arrangements, transcriptions, and things which excite young budding pianists just with fireworks. But then you get bored with them very quickly.
So you want something of real, real kind of meaty.
Uh-huh. Really. Yeah.
And you started off with your husband playing, Alexei, playing two piano works, duet works. How is that different from playing solo? What are the differences and which one do you think you prefer?
Well, I like solo. the life is such, you know, we have to communicate with other people as we live. So we're social creatures, and the same with music. We're social creatures in music, you know. I'm playing tonight Rock 2 here. Right. And you cannot just be this kind of prima donna and ignore everybody. So all musicians and orchestra and conductor have to serve you. It's collaboration. And collaboration is great when, you know, the sum is bigger than parts. So that's the magical part about it. And I cannot really say that it's not my favorite part, just doing it. But collaboration is a secret.
Yeah, okay. And I've got to talk to you about your YouTube channel. It's amazing how wonderful that's how it's taken off. What was the idea when you first started? I know you had a MySpace channel to start with. So what was the moment you said, I've got to start putting myself out on the internet playing? Did it happen naturally or did you make a conscious decision?
But look, it was so recent, you know, it seems so far away. We think of, you know, MySpace, it's something, you know, that was like for our grandmothers. But yet it was so recent, now it disappeared, you know. I had big following on MySpace and I just started with YouTube. For most important reason, you know, MySpace, you talk with people. On YouTube, you play for people. Playing is the most important part. You know, yeah, communication is nice. You know, people enjoy when you answer to them directly, not, you know, your team answers to them. But yet, being able, you know, to play something for people, and yes, you don't play at the moment, but, you know, there are so many people every day, you know, who find your clips everywhere in the world. Where you don't even dream of coming, you know, you have people from Iran sometimes, and we just read news, you know, like how they banned the symphony orchestra there. So it's so difficult, but yet people are able to go behind, you know, this firewall, which is put by governments, and break in through this firewall. It's the same, you know, as we used to have, you know, this wall between West and East. Yes. Now there are those artificial walls on internet that are erected, you know, by people who shouldn't be doing it. But yet people are coming there and they're still, you know, they're enjoying music and they do anything, you know, to get there and to enjoy music. And when you do a YouTube clip and you know that so many people will watch it later, that gives any clip a special meaning.
Yes. And you've moved on to live streaming now, because you're live streaming some of your concerts and your practice sessions. So obviously this is great for your fans, but I guess it disciplines you to practice as well, because you go for hours practicing. I'm amazed. It's fantastic.
Yeah, actually, you know, I spend a lot of time at piano, but sometimes, you know, internet life takes best part of me. And sometimes, you know, I sit and I practice and I do emails. Of course, I hate Mondays, you know, when all the emails start coming in and all of them are urgent. But at least, you know, when I'm doing it publicly and people see it and people want to see me play rather than answer my emails, it's better. So at least I can keep my computer away, because it's working, you know, it's processing live stream, digesting it, instead of being next to piano and typing out.
Yeah. Well, you've recorded all of Rachmaninoff's piano and orchestral works. I think you recorded them last year. Mm-hmm. And what is it that draws you to Rachmaninoff specifically? Because you've played these pieces for a lot, haven't you, over the years?
Yes. You know, as people say, there are certain stereotypes about Rachmaninoff, you know, this gloomy Russian, they were depressed, and yet this music is so emotional, so sentimental. Yes, it's the same. Yes, it's very emotional music, and he also talks to us, you know, in a very direct way. Mm. He's not using, you know, some strange, you know, phrases or constructions to talk. He talks to you in such ways that we understand him, he almost lives with us. And also, you know, playing so many of his concertos, they're so different, you know. Mm. There are very few composers who wrote so many which would be so much different. You know, if you take probably Beethoven would be equivalent with his 5, because the difference between number 1 and number 4, it's like so many different lives between those pieces. So it's not, you know, over and over the same, just beautiful melodies, very popular pieces, lots of notes. They're so different. They have such different
characters.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what can we look forward to hearing next year? What are your plans for 2013? Recordings and concerts?
Concerts, more concerts.
Lots
because
concerts.
Yes, I have a backlog of recordings, you know, coming out, because Rachmaninoff set will be coming probably in February, March. in, you know, in physical set and CDs.
You've released the second concerto
already.
Second
came out, yes, number three is on the way, probably in a few weeks. Then there will be one for Rhapsody, and then they all come as shiny CDs.
Box set.
Box set, beautiful box set with pictures.
Oh,
and actually that,
that
picture, which is on digital now, you know, with those wings, actually, like everything, it's not fake. Okay, which is great, but those are actually, you know, wind-blown dress in the cold, miserably cold place in Paris, and running from police at the same time. So we were on the run, and, you know, the photographer just took this picture, it was amazing.
It's a good picture,
yeah,
I have to say, it's really fantastic.
Yeah.
What does playing the piano mean to you?
Everything.
Everything.
Yes, that pretty much sums it up. No, that's my life. Everything is around it. Yes, you know, I have my family there inside of this life because they're constantly on the road with me.
Thank you so much for joining me here today.
My pleasure. Yeah, thank
it's
you.
Wonderful talking to you.
Thanks.